Rabboni, that I may see. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. This last Sunday of what's properly Lent, because next week, Passion Week, is considered a distinct season, as we mentioned to you at the rite of coming into the harbor on Sunday evening, that opens up that week of our Lord's Passion. So coming on this Sunday in the Gospel of St. Mark, we come in a sense to like the apogee, the pinnacle of the notion of conversion, of what requires of us not only that we have faith, and that we also know that we need to be healed, the phrase from the blind man, Rabboni, that I may see, but in saying it out loud, the acknowledgement of it. That's why the aspect of penitence, confession of our sins, all of this aspect is a path that we follow on the way to our Lord. But at the same time, the blind man is also, there's an intimacy here by the term which is used. In the lectionary, we have translated the word master. Master, in America especially, we think about slavery. Master is actually from the Latin word magister, which means teacher. But the term actually in the gospel is Rabboni. My teacher. There's an intimacy here which is not just rabbi, teacher, but Rabboni. And we're going to hear it again in a few weeks' time when Mary Magdalene finds our Lord in the garden on the day of the resurrection. She doesn't recognize him. She thinks he's the gardener, we're told in the gospel. I mean, she sees him, she's talking to him, but she doesn't see him. She doesn't recognize him. Until he says to her, Mary. And in hearing her name, now she sees, and she says, Rabboni, my master, my teacher. And she falls on her knees in front of him, and then begins to grab him around the knees in this great joy. So there's an intimacy in both of these, and they echo one another. The blindness of this man outside of Jericho. And obviously, he's known to the community. We're given a personal name for this blind man. We don't usually receive names for the people that are healed. But this man obviously has a place in the community that's known, and his father is known. It's a strange gospel because translating in the Greek, they're translating directly from the Aramaic. Because Bartimaeus means son of Timaeus. And so to say Bartimaeus, who is the son of Timaeus, well, anybody would know that by his name in the first place. But he's someone who's known to the community. And of course, the gospel finishes by telling us that once he arrives at this point of recognizing and saying out loud, Lord, that I may see, we're told he follows our Lord with this miracle. He follows him on the way. And the way is the terminology, if you read the Acts of the Apostles, the way is the term which is applied to the gospel and our Lord's teaching before the disciples begin to call themselves Christians in Antioch. The term is just the way. This is the path that's been shown to us by the Messiah. Now in the Syriac Fathers, the church, the vision is of a robe of glory, this life of grace that we receive. And it's why in Genesis they interpret that when Adam and Eve fall, when humanity falls by its sin of origin, we're told in the scriptures a very short line, and they saw that they were naked. The Syriac tradition, it really emphasizes that humanity was clothed in glory before that sin. And that the spiritual life, starting with baptism, which is why we garment and clothe in white, newly baptized, but that the notion of the spiritual life is us to work toward regaining this robe of glory and to return to paradise, to return to the garden as humanity was originally created in grace. So that's one vision that's going on here. And we see it in Bartimaeus when he's told, be of good cheer, courage. Yeah, I know we were telling you to shut up just a minute ago, but now he wants you to come over here. What we're told is he immediately throws off his cloak and jumps up and goes to see our Lord. Now, in the interpretations that are given then, in this robe of glory. What Bartimaeus is throwing off quite quickly in response is the cloak of Jericho, the clothing of Jericho. And Jericho in the Gospels always represents worldliness, concerns only of things here below. Jericho, as I mentioned to you, was the resort town for Jerusalem. It's only about 13, 16 miles outside of Jerusalem, but it's an oasis, and it was a place to go. It was very nice, very pleasant. And so our Lord meets him outside of Jericho, outside of the worldliness, but he's clothed in Jericho's garb. And so when our Lord calls him, he throws off this garb in order to set himself on the way. He throws off his worldliness and his worldly concerns up until this point. Now mind you, that the worldliness is not something which negated his faith. He believed, but he was not yet perfect, and he certainly didn't see. He's blind. And his blindness reduces him to being a beggar. In the gestures that we make when we pray, when our hands are folded, the reason why we make this gesture is because our hands are empty. We put them together to indicate precisely the fact that they are empty. That's the original meaning of this gesture. And we know here that in the context of this gospel, what is also taking place is this is the last miracle in the Gospel of St. Mark before our Lord's Passion. This is the end of chapter 10 of St. Mark. Chapter 11 is going to begin. What immediately takes place after this is Palm Sunday, next week. But prior to it, our Lord gives the last and the final announcement, foretelling of his Passion. He tells them, we're going up to Jerusalem now, just before this episode. So as they go past Jericho to Jerusalem, that's when they meet the blind beggar. But he tells them, we're going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man is going to be betrayed, imprisoned, spit upon, and put to death, crucified. But on the third day, he will rise again. The apostles don't hear this. In St. Luke, it's repeated three times. They don't understand what he says, they don't get what he's saying, and they don't understand. Three different ways he says, they're clueless, they don't get this. They have now been with our Lord for 3 years, seeing miracles, the multiplications of the loaves and fishes, listening to the teaching day in and day out. Progress of the spiritual life to return to the robe of glory and to return to paradise is lifelong. We never finish this path. So the Passion is announcing beforehand. It's going to begin with Palm Sunday, just after this episode, when they leave Jericho and arrive in Jerusalem. And in between we have then this miracle of the blind beggar. And just before we have another example of the apostles being blind. It's the episode where James and John come to our Lord. And they say, all right, you're going to establish this new kingdom. Make us number one and number two in it. Make us CFO and CEO, or at least put us on the board of trustees, make us part of it. And our Lord, of course, famously says to them, you don't know what you're asking for. They're 20-somethings. Of course they know what they're asking for. 20-somethings, oh, we always know. When we're young, we are immortal, and we have infused wisdom and knowledge. We know this. Everyone else is stupid. So these young men, of course everyone's young in this band. St. Peter might have been a bit older, but older meaning he's in his 30s. And when they come up and he says, you don't know what you're asking for, can you drink the chalice which is mine? And in the Old Testament, in the Psalms and the prophets, the notion of the chalice is, that's your destiny. It's what God has given, poured out for you. Can you do this? Well, of course, these 20-somethings have no idea what that actually means. He's just told them, we are going to go be crucified and publicly humiliated in Jerusalem. Yeah, they answer, we can do this. And he tells them, the challenge you will partake of, but to give you positions at the board of trustees is not mine, but my Father's to give. Then we're told they arrive at Jericho, and we have today's gospel. So we have apostles who have been with our Lord, God incarnate, day in and day out for 3 years, and they still don't see. This is the important thing that we note here. Bartimaeus believes. He knows our Lord is the Messiah, which is why when he hears in the crowd this commotion and they tell him it's Jesus of Nazareth, he knows this is the Messiah, and he believes, which is why when he calls on our Lord's name, he calls him Son of David. This is a messianic title. He believes that our Lord is the promised one. He has faith, but it's not perfect. There's always progress for us to make. We are not once saved, always saved people. The church has never had that thought. Baptism is the beginning of this pathway. It is not the end and the full conclusion. It only puts us on the way. And that's why when the people around our Lord having this concern, telling this man to be quiet, stop shouting, this is unseemly. In any way, you're a beggar. Who do you think you are to talk to the rabbi of Nazareth? We're told that he shouts out even more. This time he just drops our Lord's name. He just calls out, Son of David, have mercy on me. Reiterating this faith. But you'll notice that when the beggar is brought to him, and it's why it's important for us on this last week of Lent proper, initiating Hosanna week, leading up to Hosanna Sunday, that what our Lord does when the man arrives, our Lord sees that he's a beggar. Our Lord sees that he's blind. He's led over. But our Lord then says to him out loud, what is it that you want me to do for you? Well, most people in the crowd would have thought, isn't it obvious? He's blind. But our Lord makes Bartimaeus say this out loud. This is the connection with our notion of confession, of our repentance, of what we say out loud. Our Lord knows our sins. But he has the sacrament of penance because it is the moment, like Bartimaeus, for us to come and say, Rabboni, that I may see. Teacher, that I may be able to see. And the sacrament of penance works in the same way. Our Lord knows what we've done wrong. He knows what our wounds are. He knows what needs to be healed. But he makes us acknowledge that fact. And hence the institution of the mystery of penance. It is the reason why the very obviously blind man and the very obviously poor beggar is made to say out loud what he is actually looking for. Rabboni, that I may see. And remember the intimacy of calling him my teacher. Illuminate my mind. If you look at the prayers at the beginning of this Mass today, you see that it opens up. We ask for our hearts and our consciences, our minds to be opened to the light of the gospel. Penetrate us further. Garb us in the robe of glory. And on that last point of healing to leave you with, is that this year we're going to do the rite of the lamp that's on Thursday of Great and Passion Week. Oftentimes, in the recent years, you've done it at noon. But we're going to do it at 6 p.m. in the evening, the lighting of the lamp. And for those who have been there, you know, it's the kind of unusual bread dough with 7 candles stuck into it, and oil that is blessed. Part of the ceremony amongst the prayers is we are asking for healing. The rite of the lamp is a very ancient Syriac practice during this Passion Week. Because we open it up on Palm Sunday evening with coming into the harbor, we go through the masses Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and on Wednesday evening before we open up the third of the Triduum, the Great Thursday of the Divine Mysteries, Good Friday, Saturday of the Great Light, we open it by Wednesday evening with the rite of the Lamb, and we step forward to be anointed with the blessed oil on our foreheads, just like extreme unction when we're dying. Because we are asking for that healing grace to renew our minds at the end of the great fast. And now, with having come into the harbor and been anointed by our Lord's grace, by the right of the Lamb, we now are well to enter with our Lord into Jerusalem for Thursday, Friday, and Saturday to receive his healing and to walk as Bartimaeus does along the way. But to follow the way faithfully, we have to acknowledge that we need sight, and that is grounded on that faith in our Lord. May our faith be increased, our charity enlivened. May Bartimaeus himself intercede for us in these prayers, so that each one of us can stand before our Lord to say, Rabboni, my Master, open my mind, open my conscience, that I may see. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.